This morning we're in Mark chapter 10. It opens up by Mark's teaching on divorce, but since we cover that in detail in Matthew and Luke's account, I wanted to bring to us the story of the rich young ruler for us. But before we even get there, Jesus once again teaches us concerning the importance of children within our lives as we look at verse 13. He says, and they brought young children to Jesus that he should touch them. But the disciples felt that it was an annoyance. Otherwise, as they started bringing kids to Jesus, they basically were saying to the parents, don't bother the Lord with the kids. Come on, the Lord doesn't want to be bothered with kids. And he began to rebuke the parents there in verse 13. And when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased. And this much displeased is a little bit stronger than when we think about. Really, he was filled with indignation. He was upset with his disciples at that time for trying to keep the children from coming to the Lord, trying to keep anybody from coming to the Lord and to get not only help, that he can, be able to bless their lives. See, Jesus always wanted to be open and available to people. It doesn't matter their age, their situation. He's always there to minister to their needs. Even when you think like, oh, the Lord's too busy, he doesn't have time to minister to kids, they were there. And he wanted to bless them. The parents brought them to the Lord, so he took time for them. I know within my own life, sometimes people say, well, we don't want to bother your pastor because you're too busy. Hang on. When it comes to talking to people about Jesus, I'm never too busy. I always want to make myself available. And how much more did our Lord want to minister to these kids? And as he goes on in verse 13, and he said to them, allow those little children to come to me. He says, don't stop them. Allow them to come. Don't forbid them. Of such is the kingdom of God. And verily I say to you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. He's using this situation to really teach a very important spiritual truth to us. How do children come? They come really by faith, don't they? Very dependent. I know that little ones get really dependent upon their parents for food. Even they get dependent upon their parents to change their diapers. They're really dependent. I've discovered that as being a new grandpa. They cry a lot if they don't get their way, right? And he's really showing how don't stop them from getting the help that they need. And he says, we should be always going to our Lord as our, dependent upon him to help us. He says, we should have that simple faith and just loving Jesus like a child would love the Lord. And he took them up in his arm. What a beautiful picture. Jesus caring for him and took him up in his arm. In verse 17, now as he shifts gears, he says, now when he had gone forth into the way that he's telling us in verse 17 is, of course, the way now towards Jerusalem. From chapter 10 through the end of the Gospel of Mark, we're starting to enter into the last phase of the life of Jesus here on earth. Believe it or not, we're already heading to Jerusalem. We won't be going into Capernaum anymore. We're making our way to Jerusalem. Remember, it wasn't very long ago where Jesus was there in the most northern part up there on Mount Hermon, up at the Mount of Transfiguration, where he had that meeting with Moses and Elijah. And of course, the other gospel said they were talking about the death and the suffering that Jesus was going to go through. And so as he met with there in the Mount Transfiguration, he's been telling us, his disciples, that the Son of Man must suffer, be put to death, and then he would rise again the third day. Well, now he's making his way. He's making his way, and it's like he set his face like a flint, and nothing was going to stop him from the cross of Calvary, as he said, for this is the reason he was born into this world, in order to redeem us. So he's making his way to that. In verse 17, as he goes on, It says, and there's one who came running to him and kneeled to him and asked him, good master, what shall I do that I might inherit eternal life? The other gospels tell us that he was young and that he was rich. One of the gospels tells us that he was a ruler of the area. So that's where we get this idea of a rich young ruler. He was a man that had everything that was going for his life. He was young, he had money, he had power, he had everything that you could imagine. But yet, he still lacked something, didn't he? You know, it's amazing that even though when you have everything, if you don't have a relationship with God, how empty your life could still be, how you miss everything. And you think success is what's going to bring you that place of fulfillment. Before our president was president, Donald Trump once said, he says that excitement is in the seeking. Once you have found it, it's no longer exciting. It's seeking it is first is where all the excitement is. Ted Turner said the excitement is in the chase. Once you've caught it, it's empty. But that excitement is in the chase and the fantasy of having it. And the sad thing is that's the way so often people think they are. If only they could make it, then they would be okay. And this fellow, of course, he was empty. There was something that was missing in his life. Maybe he was there in Capernaum and see Jesus with the children and everybody, you know, his life being full and so excited. And he had his position. He had power. He had everything. He says, there's something I like to have. Did you hear what he said to the Lord? What must I do to inherit eternal life? I think his thought was really a lot with the way mankind thinks so often, because we basically are all capitalists around the world. We think of if we can do it, we're going to make it happen. I don't know if I was brought up that way. Maybe you have had that in your business career, whatever you could do. I always figure I could push and shove and make my way through this life. And I remember an industry that I was involved with. It was a very competitive industry. It was actually plastics, and we were the leader of the industry at that time, and we were certainly developing product and new products. You're always doing that, and one of the products you look at, it's kind of silly, but how could you keep a cup of pudding fresh and put it out there in the marketplace because you'd have a problem with the moisture and bacteria getting in there? Well, you can put foil over there, but it didn't seal properly. So how could you do a vacuum seal over the top of it? You know, it had to be some thin membrane. How could you come up with that? Well, we put all kinds of time and energy into that product. But the competition was so exciting. It was so thrilling. We finally got it. We start, okay, now what's next? You know, there's always that thrill of going on to what's next that's going to be fulfilling. And I can relate to this rich young ruler. I can relate to the capitalist that he was at that time. But all that you could do, the chase, the seeking to find fulfillment, doesn't meet this spiritual need of your life. And only when you come to Jesus Christ is that fulfillment ever, ever met. He said, tells us in verse 18, and I like this question. He says, why do you call, Jesus said to it in response to the rich young man, why do you call me good? There's only one that is good. And that is God. From that, of course, we have two conclusions what Jesus was saying. Jesus was saying, hey, I'm no good, or Jesus is really awakening in this man the consciousness that Jesus was God standing right there in human flesh. I believe that this was the correct understanding that he was saying to him. Jesus is saying to him, look, without realizing, you're recognizing something that I am what you're looking for when he was there standing before the Lord. What you need is God in your life, he was telling him, and I am the answer. Can you imagine this fella standing right before Jesus himself and had that privilege of everything that he looked for is found in the person of Jesus Christ. Everything that he was seeking, and, you know, the money wasn't able to give it to him, and having all the power and everything that we think that's going to satisfy you, and it just doesn't. In verse 19, he says, you know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not kill. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud and honor your father and mother. And the sixth commandment and the second tablet of the law that dealt with the man's relationship with fellow man. And he said, Lord, I've observed these all from my youth. And so he's dealing with the second half of the Ten Commandments as Jesus is talking about. And this guy, look at, he had to be somebody that everybody must have really liked. He said, I did all these things from my youth. He obviously was a very good man. He probably shared his wealth. He probably a very moral man, and I don't believe that this was an empty boast that he was saying. It was part of his life. He says, I've done this, everything. You know, I was brought up this way. I was brought up to do good. I was brought up to care about people, do something. But you know what? I've done all the good works, but there's still something missing. There's something missing in my life, and that's the sad thing about religious and, you know, affairs that people get themselves doing is that they think they can fulfill your life. Good works cannot fulfill the emptiness in a man's life. That thing was only thing that could ever fulfill anybody is a right relationship with God. And I, when you look at verse 21, as he opens up in first part of verse 21, Jesus looked at him and loved him. I like this. Here was this self-made young man, but I think really what he loved about him is that this fellow was being honest with Jesus. He wasn't making a false kind of boastful statement, and Jesus could have cut him on that or said something bad about him, but he didn't. He saw he was earnest. He saw that he was seeking to know God. And I think that's what the Lord is always looking for, is people, men and women, that would seek him, to seek to know him. As he goes on in verse 21, and he said unto him, one thing that thou lack, go your way and sell whatever you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven, and come and take up the cross and follow me. And he went his way sad, this rich man, and he was grieved in the statement because he had great possession. A very wealthy man. But Jesus says, there's one thing that you lack. What do you think that he's lacking? And when you look at him into this world, you think, my goodness, he's got everything. How could he be lacking anything? It's interesting. In the first part of the tablets of the Ten Commandments, in the first part deals with our relationship with God. What is the first commandment? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Very important. And the Lord touched on exactly what the man's problem was. Though he had kept it morally, the second tablet, like I mentioned, he was a very moral man, treated his neighbors right, but he didn't have a relationship with God because the God of his life that he was worshiping and he was living for was his possessions, his position, his power. And the Lord just simply says, go take that which is keeping you from a right relationship with me and get rid of it. Go sell everything that you have and just give it away and follow me. It was a God that was keeping him from surrendering everything to God is so empty. It's a false God. And Jesus said, look, if you want to be perfect, if you want to be right, come and surrender your life for me. Jesus said in Matthew's account and Mark here too, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and pick up his cross and follow me. Are we willing to do that this day? Are we willing to follow the Lord? And of course, in our story, we realize he had great possessions. That love of things, the love of possessions was hindering his walk with the Lord. But, you know, in our lives, it could be something different. It'd be something else that we put in such a high priority within our life that's keeping our lives from really going forward and following the Lord and seeking him. Saul, before he was Paul, he was had something that was keeping him before from knowing God. It was his religion. He was the Pharisee of the Pharisees. He had zeal, he had power, he had everything, but he didn't have a relationship with God. There's so many things that in this world that can occupy our mind and our thoughts that keep us from a right relationship with God. And normally, bottom line, it comes from our pride. As he says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? If I could do it, then I'm going to do it. Jesus just got done teaching us how we find eternal life. He says, if you become as a child, to become as a child as we humble ourselves, as we trust in him, and we believe in that finished work of Jesus Christ, then we have eternal life. So as Jesus speaks to us, whatever it is in your life that's standing in the way of full commitment to following Jesus, then put it out of your life. There's nothing worthwhile to hang on to. I saw a picture of myself recently, well, this morning, that it showed me a few years ago where I was skiing up at Mammoth. There was a picture that I saw this morning. And I go, oh, my goodness, what happened to that young fella? You know, where I used to kick snow up and used to, you know, like to spray powder on my friends as they would fall down in front of me and thought I was a hot dog, right? Well, as age creeps up on you, and it seems like that happened yesterday. But as it gets older, we realize how quick our life, that our life just kind of zooms through our hands, doesn't it? You know, and I keep in my mind think I could still ski, but my body after working yesterday realized maybe not. Jesus said, what is the profit of man, oh rich man? What is the profit any of us to gain the whole world and lose our own soul? We live this life. Some of us make it 60, 70, some in the 80s. We lost a great, great friend of all of ours here this past week. His name was Jim Bell. If anybody knew, he moved to heaven. We don't know how long a life that we have. And what he's saying, he says, are you going to live for your riches? Are you going to live for this world? Or are you going to live for me? Because the promises I have last for eternity. Notice now in verse 23, then Jesus, as he walked away, this poor guy looked around about and said to his disciple, how hard shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? Otherwise, what difficulty they have. Now the disciples were astonished. And Jesus said again, you know, really, children, how hard it is for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. And they were astonished out of measure. In other words, they were really blown away. And they said amongst themselves, then who can be saved? Of course, the story, the illustration was common to them, but not necessarily they understand it is to us because, you know, an eye of a needle, and what they were really a reference to is when you would go into a city, normally, you know, any city would have a great gate as you would go into the town. In fact, if you go over there now, you could still see remnants of the gates as you would enter in. And during the night, they would close the gates, the main gates where the caravans could enter into the city and all that. You could only do that during the light of day. Well, they would keep this small gate where you could access that you could get in as an individual. It was very small that you could get that was a door within a door type of a gate. And they would say that if you were come in late after hours and everything was closed, that you could get through that little gate and get yourself into the city. And if you happen to want to get your camel in there, you had to take everything off your camel. And then you had to get behind there, one on one side, pull that camel through, and the other one pushing that camel through, the squeezing through the gate. And so that's what he's saying. It was very hard to get through, you know, through there. And it's kind of this idea of salvation. You know, he says, you can't really push your way into heaven, can't you? You can't pull your way into heaven. And so they were just amazed that he was saying, how in the world, if rich people can't be saved, how can anybody else be saved? Notice the Lord's response in verse 27. He says, with men, it is impossible. Salvation is impossible by your own merit. What must I do to inherit eternal life? I cannot do it. My good works, as good as you might think I am, I miss the mark according to God's standards. We all miss the mark. And Jesus just simply said to him, with men, excuse me, it is impossible. You can't save yourself, no matter how moral that you might be, or how many things that you give away and how many good works that you do. I'm not saying that you shouldn't be doing that, but they are not tied to salvation. It took the shed blood of Jesus Christ. That's why he's going to Jerusalem right now. As he's on the way, remember, he's left Capernaum. He's all along the road, making his way through Jericho and then up to Jerusalem for the purpose of redemption. But then as he goes on in verse 27, but not with God. With God, all things are possible. Do you believe that today, church? Do you believe that with God, all things are possible? He says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I believe that God, don't you? That did that, brought everything into being. He says, redeem mankind. It's going to cost me a great price, the greatest price, the death of the only begotten son, but I'm willing to do it, and I'll pay for their redemption. And it blows me away how much God loves me. Like sometimes I wonder, I say, God, don't you really know who I am, and you would pay that price for me? But yet he does know me, and he loves me. Salvation came to us through Jesus Christ, and Peter began to say in verse 28, we have left all and followed you. And that's a true statement. They left their nets, their boat, their lifestyle, and everything, and they followed him. And Jesus said, verily, I say to you, there's no man that has left house, brothers, or sisters, or fathers, or mothers, or wives, or children, or lands for my sake and the gospel's sake. Otherwise, it's always important to emphasize it's for the Lord and for the gospel's sake, not for weirdness' sake that some people like to do. But again, in the contents of the rich man, as what they were thinking, and also in Peter saying, you know, we left everything, and Jesus says, well, that's good that you left everything, but you should receive a hundredfold now, and now in this time, house, brothers, sisters, and mothers, and children of the land, with persecution in the world to come, eternal life. See, Peter, even though you might have given this stuff up in service of me, even though, you know, you might have given things up that maybe you don't get invited as many different cocktail parties as you used to, or be able to go to social events because they found out you're a Christian. We don't like to hang out with those Christians because they'll bring up the Bible. You might say, Lord, look at all the different things I've given up. But the Lord here is saying to Peter, he says he wouldn't be a debtor to any man. He's not a debtor to us. He says, I've given you something that's even better than anything that you could ever give up. I've given you eternal life. He's given us hope not only for today, but hope for tomorrow. You don't say. And when I we'll pick up the rest of the story next week as we continue along. You know, read ahead if you have some time this week. But when I look at Jesus and we think about his teaching that he'll be share with his disciples here in a little bit, because he'll keep reminding them that he's going to die, he's going to suffer, and in the third day he's going to rise from the dead. And finally the disciples get troubled. You remember the story of John chapter 14? He says, oh, don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. He says, I'm going to go away, but I'm coming back again. I'm going away to build you a mansion, a dwelling place for where I am, there where you always will be. We're going to be in the presence of the Lord. And he says, yeah, you might have given up a few things there in this lifetime, but it can't be compared for the eternity that I have for you. Is it a very sad story that we read here this morning, where that rich young ruler had a choice to make, and he went away sorrowful? I often wonder, and I hope, because I seem like I'm always hoping for people's life, that down the road of peace, that he counted the cost, that he made a decision to follow Jesus Christ. But the story, the way we look at it, that he just went his way and he continued on his life. And what do you get at the end of your life? I think it was Pastor Greg that said, there's no U-Hauls going to heaven. You can't take it with you, can you? It all stays here. It ends up going in your garage, and then from your garage, you don't know what to do with it, and you've got to load up a truck and take it to the dump. It's so sad. The things that we lay our treasures upon. Help us to lay our treasures in heaven. Help us to seek ye first the kingdom of God, to live for him this week, because we don't know how long we have. The Lord could take us home today, tomorrow. We could be caught up together, in the presence of the Lord. We don't know. But one thing we do know is that he'll be with us, and our future is bright. Our future is exciting. So let's go forward in the name of the Lord. Father, we thank you for our time together. Thank you as we read a story that's so familiar to all of us, where we see your love for children. Then we see how you simply spoke to us about that simplicity of faith, like a child, to believe your word, the promises that you give us. Sometimes we try to complicate things way, way, way too much. I bet you laugh at me all the time with that. And you just want me just to believe and trust in you. But it really comes to our choice, like as we saw in the story of that rich man, that he had a choice to make. He had a crossroad in his own life to choose. But he went away sorrowful. Lord, I just pray that we would make a choice this day. If anybody's watching us online that doesn't know you, they would count the costs of what they have in this world compared to the things that you promise for eternity, and they would choose you. Help us this week to prioritize all the time, to put you first within our life, that we don't allow any other gods, any other things to come in our relationship, between our relationship with you, Lord. And if we have, please forgive us. Please allow us to let those things go, that we put you first in our lives. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Holy.